All right. Well, from that, I want to let you know we're going to show, we're going to take the Sue Jeffers clip next, and then go the Carver County, Lea, and Simon route. We're going to do those clips. But I had the fortune of being on Sue Jeffers' show last Saturday. And so if that can be ran now, I'll just speak over it. There we are. Well, there's a big pole in front of Sue Jeffers' face. But we're at the News Talk AM 30 radio. On the left is Lea Banken. Of course, I'm there in the middle. And we're just kind of right there listening. And but it was good to be on there. Now, Lea Banken is with the blog CarverCountyCorruption.com. And she's exposing what's taking place in the courts in Carver County. And she's just been trampled by Judge Perkins, and her rights and her liberties are, and kids have been taken away without due process. I mean, this is a tragedy. Now, this happens all the time in our court. It happens a lot, I should say, not all the time. But there are bad judges out there. There are a lot of good judges that do good things, but there are bad ones too. So anyway, thank you, Sue Jeffers, for having us on. But the next clip, there was a hearing down at, it was a week ago Wednesday, at the House Judiciary and Civil Law Committee. It was a joint committee. They met together to talk about, judicial reform, specifically removing the word incumbent from the ballot and changing the retirement day for judges so judges wouldn't get appointed and they can finish out their term. So there was a lot of discussion going on there, but I want you to hear what this Judge Jeff Thompson has to say. And he mentions Carver County, but then he does some veiled threat. I consider them veiled threats to the lawyers in the legislature. So let's hear what he has to say.
Judicial conduct. That can go to the Board of Judicial Standards. And I will tell you, as a judge, getting an envelope from the Board of Judicial Standards, like a personal and confidential, is a very serious matter. I have, you know, that we hear that the people on the internet talk about judges are corrupt. I, at one hearing, heard a website called CarverCountyCorruption.com. And I read that, and I have been the subject of a couple of internet websites myself. One is angryjeweler.com, feel free to look at that. And another is POWmadeak47.com. That guy doesn't like me neither. But it has been said that the internet is the vanity press of the demented. I don't pay any attention to what comes on the internet. It has to have some other serious source. We have one woman sending us so much stuff through the internet that we have had to order her to stop because we just can't afford all the paper. So, lazy judges, bad judges, arrogant judges, no, we are accountable for that. And we take that very seriously, both at the board level, at the district level, at the courthouse level, and at the state level. Judge Werner's pulling out.
All right, that was not the clip that had the threat in it. It's kind of scrambling here, but it was interesting. If you write something on a blog, it's the vanity press of the demented. There can't be, he didn't say this, but he's implying there can't be any truth on the internet and on these blogs and anybody talking about the judiciary, okay? So if it's on the internet, yeah, you should take it, you know, you should consider where it's coming from and you should, you know, trust but verify that the information's true or not. And so he talked about Carver County corruption. So it just happened to be the person who started Carver County corruption, and contributed. I don't know if she did. I don't know all the details of how it works out, but she was there. Of course, that was Lea Banken, who, of course, was on the Sue Jeffers show with me. She got up and testified, and the judge is in the background, okay? So let's watch him respond to what she says.
My name is Lea Banken. I'm actually from Carver County, Minnesota. I am the original author of CarverCountyCorruption.com that Judge Jeff Thompson mentioned earlier. I just had a really brief testimony today. The judges should be elected by the people and accountable to the people for their actions. They should answer to the people for their wrongdoings. The Minnesota Constitution says in Article 6, Section 9, that this is the way it should be. I am a victim of an out-of-control and irresponsible judge and judicial officials. I'm one of thousands of parents and our children who have been abused and even devastated by wrongful actions of judges. I do not think this would have happened if these judges had been elected by the people and were responsible to the people. We need to follow our Constitution. We also need to judge performance evaluations by credible citizens so we know how judges are doing their job.
Thank you.
You know, the little handshake, the little wave there. It's just, oh, that was too good. But it's a problem. I mean, you know, we can joke about some of these things and see the reactions, but there's a significant problem here. To take away kids from a parent when they're normal, they're sane, they haven't had any allegations of abuse against them, and all their psych evals are fine. Three of them she's had, and the judge wants to order another one, and they, all of them would come out fine. She can't see her kids. They've been taken from her. This is a serious problem. Now, I want you to understand here that the attorneys in the legislature are a big problem to getting judicial reform. And the biggest reason that they're a problem is because the judiciary itself holds sway and holds control over their license. And it's very easy for a judge, and I think Judge Whalen out of Hennepin County doesn't have a problem with filing ethics complaints against attorneys if an attorney shows that there may be corruption in the courtroom. So, but we're gonna show a clip here with Representative Simon going and saying, hey, these are, and it's important here, these are people who are upset because the decision went against them. You know what? Yes, absolutely. People are upset. And he'll mention my name in here. They absolutely are upset that the decision went against me. But there's something more to it than that. It's the way the decision went against me. A total disregard for the Constitution, a total disregard for the process, due process, and a total, just an arrogance that's beyond arrogance. And Representative Simon represents this arrogance because not only does he say it's disgruntled or implies disgruntledness, he says we are saying that it's a systemic, and some people think it's systemic, but it's a problem throughout the whole judiciary, okay, and it's not. But in one sense, it is systemic in that the whole judiciary knows it's going on and aren't doing something, just as the legislature knows it's going on and isn't doing anything. So let's see what Representative Simon has to say.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I really applaud Representative Blesch's comments and Representative Gruenhagen's. I think that's kind of the nuance that we need here. And in some of these judicial reform hearings, I guess what troubles me, and I have my own bill that I've been collaborating with Representative Beard on and others for a number of years, but the point is, I think we just have to be really careful here. I understand Mr. McGrath and Mr. Kinley and Mr. Nathan and others are very passionate about this, but I think we have to be very careful going forward at this hearing and others to confuse, you know, we have a lot of litigants who don't like the outcomes. But that is not the same as corruption. And I just really hope that going forward, I don't care where anyone is on these issues, that we can really distinguish here. Because you lost in court.
No comments from outside the committee.
I just hope going forward that we can distinguish that. I get the mailings. Mr. Nathan is very prolific. He sends out, you know, at least a couple a month. and they all are centered on court cases that he or his clients lost. And that's fine. You can make the argument that the judge got it wrong. We have two layers of review in the state. We have a Court of Appeals, the Supreme Court, and possibly the U.S. Supreme Court if it's an issue of federal or constitutional significance. So two or possibly three layers of review. The point is, and I'm not making a judgment about any particular case, and it could be that all of Mr. Nathan's clients, or it could be that Mr. McGrath or Mr. Kinley or others were done wrong, and that there were really bad decisions on the law. But that is different than alleging corruption. Corruption, to me at least, just kind of a common sense term, implies that someone's on the take, or someone is making a decision that they know to be wrong, or that someone is doing something somehow illegal. But just making the wrong call, the subjectively wrong call, or ending up on the wrong end, while it may be worth redress, is not corruption. That's not corruption. And I think we get a disturbing intermingling of those terms here, which implies something is not there. We may have a judge in a particular case, or even in a pattern of cases, we may have judges, I don't know the answer, who are making the wrong call. But I think we really have to refrain from calling that corruption and alleging that because someone decided a case the way, or the outcome came out the way that we don't want it, that somehow that means that the judiciary, the entire judiciary from top to bottom, is rotten and corrupt. I that's a real stretch, and I just hope we keep those two things separate.
You know, I applaud Representative Simon. So much of what he said there is absolutely true, 100% true. It does need to be nuanced because there is a difference between a wrong call, okay, and corruption. Absolutely, that's the case. But there is a difference between corruption and a wrong call. But he won't say that. And second of all, he throws my name in there as if I was complaining about my case. When I testified down there, I testified twice. I spoke directly to the bill about retirements, about the definition of words in the bill and why they're there, and also about the word incumbent on the ballot and why it's there and why it should be taken off for judges. That's all I spoke about. I didn't talk about corruption in my testimony, but he throws me in that group. He doesn't even know my case, okay? And my case wasn't a wrong call. It was an intentional thing. It was, I don't even know that I can call it retribution because I didn't know there was anything to, you know, come after me for. Why the judge would do that? It's just had to be some personal vendetta on the judge's part. But totally ignored the Constitution, totally ignored the rule of law, and totally ignored due process. See, and when you talk to an attorney and you explain very simply, there's no findings of fact, there's no conclusions of law, but it was thrown in the order. That means you can't defend yourself and you don't know what's coming at you. And that is not being, that's not a wrong call. That's not laziness, that's corruption. And then when you tell the judge through a review of law, hey judge, you violated my constitutional rights, here's the memorandums, and here's the four issues before you as to what was wrong with what you did and how you violated the law, and that you didn't do findings of fact and conclusions of law, and that a person has religious freedoms, and the answer comes back, my order was clear. Well, we knew the order was clear. That's why we're responding to it. Okay? So the order being clear is not the response. The response is get your findings of fact and get your conclusions of law. Because otherwise, we got to go to the appellate court, and the appellate court has to order you to do your findings of fact and conclusions of law. And then you're not going to do it, or you're going to do it, and then we got to go back to the appellate court again. And which eventually we got there 5 years later, and I was right. Okay, and that judge was wrong. But Judge Joanne Smith has another problem in that she has an ethical duty to report sexual abuse. And she testified on the stand that she saw one judge abusing one of the another a staffer there. It was actually a homosexual relationship that was going on, and she saw the abuse and did not report it. Of course, she's a lesbian judge. And so it's, you know, what's the game going on there? And of course, I'm teaching my kids the Bible. I'm finding out this all after the fact that's taken place. So she's got bigger problems and she's had bigger complaints against her. But what does the judiciary do when the judges don't have and follow the ethics? What do they do? Nothing. They ignore it. We don't know what's taken place, whether she's been disciplined or talked about or anything like that. And they ignore it. And Representative Simon, by the way he said things in the end, even though he was speaking the truth about how we need to parse these things and how the nuances need to be, he ended up going and saying, we're indicting the whole judiciary and it's a systemic problem. And I got up there later and testified, no, it's not systemic, but there's still corruption. And he even admits it may be there. Of course, he's got to sit down and listen to people. And even though he admits it may be there, what is he doing to find out about it? And I know other people have sat down with him in his office to say, this is what the judge did. And that, and he was explained very well why it was corruption and not a bad call. Oh.